Our perceptions about and understanding of science shape what we view as real and possible, how we think and even how we feel about a host of factors and topics, ranging from food to vehicles and everything in between. But the public view of science in the US today is skewed. We hear a great deal about study findings. We have more data available to us than ever before. However, the public often struggles to make sense of what it all means for their lives. When public understanding of science is lacking, we are less equipped to pursue greater good and unable to do our best to attract greater numbers of young Americans to pursue careers in science. There is a whole literature about public understanding of science, but I want to take this conversation in a different direction. I don't want to focus on specific scientific topics or findings. I want to focus on how we think and how we talk about science in general, and look at some key social processes at work shaping the discourse. There are authorities and opinion leaders, of course, but the public discourse of science belongs to all of us. We participate in and shape it together. Looking at cultural and discursive factors, I see evidence of two complex co-occurring processes lending to the skewed public view of science. We mystify and we oversimplify. So how do you observe these social processes? You defocus. Anton Ehrenzweig's Hidden Order of Art provides a useful and fascinating model. When we defocus, we go from focused examination to wide-angle, unfocused perception. The goal is to think differently about the public discourse of science. So let's look first at oversimplification. We see in the discourse a common practice of reducing scientific complexities to highly simplified talking points. For example, drinking red wine makes X outcome less likely. Eating bacon each day makes Y outcome likely. The public is presented with neat and tidy packages of information. Often the actual risk or actual benefit is inflated to get our attention, and several possible contributing factors are dropped from the explanation in favor of one that is the most surprising, exciting, or concerning. Oversimplification of information in this way is not a new topic. Many will hear this and say, yes, that's the media model at work, to simplify and shorten complex information for public consumption. However, when we defocus, we get a different view. Larger cultural ideas also influence the media. That is to say, we value simplified information and we value the novel. It's how we determine that on which we will click. So the media is simply giving us what we value. Now let's shift gears to look at mystification in the discourse. Again, let's defocus. How do we participate in mystifying science? When we hear seemingly contradictory findings or explanations, there is often a movement to dismiss those findings and sometimes the scientists who present them without looking into things further. Motivated skepticism, as discussed by Tabor and Lodge, appears to play a role here. This means we are more likely to seek and accept information that aligns with what we already think and dismiss information that does not. The problem with this is that contradictions and tensions are not worked out. The public is left to assume that some scientists are just doing science wrong, when in reality, those on opposing sides of an argument will both contribute to advancing science in the end. But when the conversation stops with dismissing and discrediting, we mystify. Another way that we mystify is through focus on discoveries. There are many examples in the discourse and the history of science of this focus. Professor Stephen Goldman, in his lecture series, Great Scientific Ideas That Changed the World, advocates for the use of the language of ideas to discuss how science advances instead of discoveries. Talking about ideas links together findings and concepts in entire veins of research, as opposed to atomizing individual achievements. But when we focus on discoveries instead of the progression of ideas, we mystify. Third and relatedly, we mystify science careers. there's a great deal of conversation in the discourse about our national need to encourage greater numbers of young Americans across all races, ethnic groups, genders, abilities, and socioeconomic statuses to pursue careers in science, opening up that gateway. However, the ways that we often talk and think about people entering and performing in these careers don't support that. Rather than focus on individual skill building and learning over time as part of a community of scientists, we often hear about, as Gibbs points out, science as, quote, the unveiling of individual brilliance. As if this isn't high enough a bar, coupled with that is an expectation of long-term certainty of one's desire to work in science. For example, an article in Scientific American about the University of Texas at Austin's Taurus program describes program goals as, quote, propelling these highly motivated students of color to astrophysics careers to which they've always aspired, end quote. This is a great program focused on inclusion, yet mystification is still evident. When we focus on science as the unveiling of individual brilliance and tack on an expectation of long-term certainty of people's desire to work in science, we mystify. Looking at these processes of oversimplification and mystification, we can begin to see them at work. But why is it that we don't generally notice them and recognize them at work? We don't notice because they blend in within our larger cultural context. They mesh with and stem from ideas about the value of filtering and simplifying information to avoid overload in our information-saturated society. They also mesh with individualism and meritocracy, those core ideas about how our society is supposed to work. And we are immersed in this context. In social psychology, we discuss this as the fish in water effect. Much like a fish in water, everything that we know and expect about science occurs within and is reliant upon this context, the discourse of science, yet we often fail to recognize it as such. However, it is within this context that we collaboratively build the public discourse of science. From the foremost experts to the average American sharing findings. As Berger and Luckman say, society is a human product. So too is the public discourse of science. And the language we use as we engage in these activities and questions and discussions erects what Kenneth Burke calls mental fences, essentially defining the correct ways to think and talk about science. Having defocused, we can see these processes at work and understand a little bit more about their power and impact. But now the question must be, what can we do about this? These social processes permeate our vital social institutions, impacting how we think and talk about science at every level. How families talk about it with children, how schools talk about it with students, how we hear about it in the media, how organizations seeking to hire people in science jobs think and talk about it. Our vital social institutions and larger cultural values are in fact enduring and resistant to change, but there are some things we can do within our current cultural context to nudge the discourse in a direction that better supports the greater good. We need meta-discourse to achieve this. First, we need to emphasize science as a process and a community endeavor. Second, we need more public discussion about the scientific method, but a defocused view of the method. Rather than focusing on the steps in the method, we need to consider the ways that human interpretation and decision-making are fundamental to using and practicing that method. And also how ideas and learning over time are fundamental to that. Talking more about the scientific method also involves talking about whether scientific findings align with or diverge from previous studies, how data are collected, and from what sources. These types of general details foster better public understanding about scientific inquiry. So, also, in addition to these things, we need more critical consumption of media information about science. What does this mean? We need to encourage people with meta-discourse to stop seeking and being drawn to the most sensational findings and the neatest packaging. We need to encourage more comfort with complexity and gray areas. Scientific knowledge changes over time and develops over time. Experts frequently disagree, but the scientific enterprise is firing on all cylinders when those disagreements have to be worked out empirically. And lastly, we need to encourage people to seek alternative perspectives and explanations, especially when positions appear polarized. There's probably middle ground there. It's just getting less coverage. Examining the public discourse of science as we have here today is inherently beneficial to the greater good because it gives us an opportunity to step back from the situation and to think about it differently, to look at larger cultural and discursive factors at work shaping the discourse in ways that we may not normally recognize. It also gives us an opportunity to start to consider strategies that we can use within our current cultural context to make change for the better. The strategies I've shared with you here today are just the beginning. I encourage each of you to think about what you can do in your roles, because again, the public discourse of science belongs to all of us. We participate in and shape it together. We contribute to the challenges we now face, but we can also contribute to the solutions to build a stronger public discourse of science that better supports the greater good.